Hey, welcome back. Tonight we are going to be tackling some porting. Now, with porting, some basic hand tools, some files, will go a long way. We'll start with the layout side of it, and we will go from there. Now, you can use something just as simple as a Sharpie. You can take it, and if you get like a nice big fat Sharpie, this one's all worn down, but you can just mark all the way around the bore in around the ports. You can also get something like layout die. This is all a little more durable. So it allows you to kind of move the piston up and down. This will wipe away pretty easily. You'll also need something like a sharp scriber. And that's pretty much all you'll need for basic hand tools to at least map out and lay out everything that you need inside the port. So I'm going to use my layout die. So there you go. You can see I gave it a nice coating just on the inside. You don't need to worry about covering the whole thing, but if you know there's spots that you're going to end up working, so on this for example, I know that I'm going to be working the top of the exhaust port, so I want to make sure that I have a nice coating there. And I'm going to be working the bottoms of the transfers, so I got a nice coating there. So next up, you want to install your cylinder.
So I have the cylinder installed with the proper base gasket that I'm going to be using when I build it up. You'll notice that the top of the piston sits pretty flush with the exhaust port. But we will notice that on the transfers, there's like a couple millimeter lip. So I'm going to be reworking those to try and remove that. So first up, we're going to scribe just the bottom at the top of the piston edge, so I have a reference to work off of and where to work to. For the next step, it's going to be the top of the exhaust port needs to be moved up a little bit. For that one, it's going to be a little bit different just because I need to know how many degrees I know what the degrees are because I've measured it from before. So it's currently has a duration of about 194, and I would like to see it probably 4 more degrees than that, 4 to 5 more degrees. So for marking the next one, we're going to have to put the degree wheel on. And then what I can do is I don't have to necessarily remap the whole thing. I know how many degrees I want it to change. So I can put the pointer on and the degree wheel, set it to an arbitrary number, whatever, and just bring it up 5 degrees from there, and then just scribe that line in as well. And that's going to be the opening edge of the exhaust port. So using a similar method as before, visually using a light for the port timing, port opening. So it looks like right about there is where the light is just starting to break through the port over the top of the piston. So I'm going to move my pointer to the nearest hole number, which in this case is 100. Yeah, I want to go 2.5 degrees up from that. And then take my scriber again and scribe a line at the top. Why 2.5 degrees? Because the duration is when the port opens and closes. So if you want to change that by 5, it's 2.5 on the up and 2.5 on the down. So with that, we can take the cylinder off, as that's pretty much all I want to change at the moment. And that's all I need the piston and the crank and all that set up to do. The rest of it, I can draw lines with it off and use those as points of reference for picking things up. Plus, the more you move the piston up and down, the more you're gonna end up scraping off your bluing. You can do this without the ring in, but I didn't do that just because.
So here we go, you can see the scribed line in the bluing, how high up I wanna move the exhaust port. And then also down on the transfers, you can see there's a scribe line under the bottom of them. This side's a little bit easier to see. And while I'm at it, I may also widen up the exhaust port a little bit more. And there's some really jagged, sharp edges on the back, on the boost port here on the back. So clean those up as well.
So porting tools. This is what I used to use, was this stuff. I have a big Dremel for doing larger things, removing a lot of material really quick in open areas that were easy to get at. And then these pneumatic ones that work pretty good. And I used to use these quite a bit, and I still do when I'm roughing stuff out, but I have since moved on to using these diamond abrasive ones. You just have a lot more control with these. It's really quite a bit easier to, you don't have to worry about these. These will bite sometimes and bounce around, and they're just really hard to control sometimes, especially when you're inside of ports. These are much easier to manage. So I have quite a few of those. But then I got one of these. Now this bad boy is a Chinese clone dental tool. It bits go in and out pretty easily. Has a little foot pedal with a variable speed. It's not bad. For the price that I paid, it is much nicer to use. It is much quieter to use than the air ones. I think it was like $100 some US maybe for this, with two different tips. The tips will break, and they're relatively cheap to get new. But if you oil them and don't try and do the impossible with them, I've used this one probably for at least 3 or 4 motor builds, although I have had to take this apart once because the bearings got full of schmoo, and the gear headed one I had some issues with. I had to take it apart as well, but it does work, and it's a lot nicer to use. Someday I might drop the coin on a really nice one, but for now the motor hasn't given me any, like the main unit hasn't given me any problems, and you can stock up on these. They're not terribly expensive. Maybe even get some nicer ones, I don't know. Let's get to knocking some metal out of that thing.
So trying to film ports is actually the worst, but there's an A-B comparison. There's unported, nothing done, and there's the ported. You can see one side is raised up a little bit more towards the top of the cylinder. So I also just kind of blended it in a little bit here compared to this side, which brought the port out just a little bit more. Not much, just a little bit. And I removed some casting imperfections that were down in the corners here. Well, this side still has it, but there's some that are down in there. I'm gonna try and remove as well. And I would try and record and show this, but it's so hard to show, unfortunately. But I am going in through the exhaust port, coming in, porting as such. So I've roughed in the transfer ports down to the bottom. Now I just have to put the 90 degree piece on and blend those in. I've also finished the exhaust port.
Unfortunately, my electric handpiece for the angled one, I have lost the locking latch for the back of the bits. It must have fallen out in the drawer somewhere, so I had to switch over to this noisy thing. There's option 2, just super glue the damn thing in.
So there we go, that's the transfers lowered. the exhaust port raised and just cleaned up. It's not hogged out very much at all. There's just some casting flaws in the corners there I cleaned out. A few little casting flaws here. Same with the transfers. I didn't really hog them out or anything. Just cleaned up a few casting flaws on the inside. Same on the roof. And in the boost port. And chamfered all the edges of all of the ports with the diamond burr. So I'm not an expert at porting. And I don't have a dyno to test a lot of this stuff, so it's mostly just seat of the pants feel kind of thing. But I will say this, bigger isn't always better. If you don't know what you're doing, it's real easy to take away a bunch of material in a place thinking that making it bigger is going to make it flow better, when you can actually decrease velocity in critical areas. That said, play around. I mean, this is about as cheap a performance mod as you can do to a two-stroke scooter. You know, you can buy a tool for $100, lay out your cylinder, and go at it and just port it yourself. And then, I mean, if you, worst case scenario, you ruin this, you buy another cylinder for a few $100, and you're back in the ballgame with some knowledge that you learned along the way.
Being happy with that, other than I gotta remove the bluing,
you can start working on the cases. So these Hondas are kind of a problem. Problem number one being they're really thin in here, and that's where the intake is. So what I did on the Stage 6 intake was I did port this out quite a bit inside of here, but then I also ported it out wide. I went pretty wide. You can actually port these out quite a bit wider in on the sides. So you can go down a little bit, and you can take a little bit out of the roof here too, but not much. And it's nice to leave that bridge in there. Otherwise, the this loses all its structure. But you can take a bit out of the floor, a bit of this here, and move the sides over a bunch to make this actually a bunch wider. On the Stage 6 one, I actually cut in a fair amount. I was actually like breaking into the stud holes, so I had to use like a sealant on the studs when I put them in. And the one other thing that I like to do with these is make up a aluminum sleeve that goes in here and locates on the back side of the seal bore. It keeps the seal from being pushed in too far, and then I can fill in all of this with Devcon or JB Weld or Belzona or whatever.
So just to give you an idea of the direction that I go, is I go into the wall here, you can get it quite a bit bigger. There's still more meat to go down if I wanted to in the floor, and there's still more meat over into the wall, and you can actually epoxy on the inside there, like right underneath this screw hole here. There's a little void you can fill with epoxy and go even wider. But this is where the bottleneck is this little opening right where my fingertip's poking through. So opening this back and opening all this back is not really effective. You can see it's quite a bit larger now. And I mean, like, this one's pretty substantial, like I can get my finger through there pretty good. And I mean, I can get the tip of my finger in that one, but it's tight. That one I got room. So that right there is what I would call pretty mild. But I did widen it out quite a bit at that bottleneck, right where this tapers down and inlets in. It could go
even a bit wider. Like if we were to measure out here, it is 46.35 millimeters. So visually, just looking at that, if we were to split the difference to both sides, could easily move either side that much on top of the width that's already there. And then its thickness six mil minus, so it's like 4 millimeters thick. So you could pull this wall down another couple millimeters, like in between in here, and definitely widen this out, like visually, like I showed you there before. But for this build, that's pretty all right. It's a lot better than it was. There's a big, you know, the cast, the factory, there's a big cast in step right there and there. And if you want to, you can also, you know, blend edges in here, sharp edges and whatnot, knock stuff down. I feel like doing anything up here is mostly a waste of time. That's kind of a dead spot anyway, the way that the reed valve sticks in through here, there's not really a whole lot of point of doing much up there. You can move this back some to help get this bigger in here, but that's about it. That's about as far as I would take it. Doing anything up here is mostly pointless, I think. So with all that done, that's most of the porting done. I am going to be making the plug that goes in there and JB welding that. I think I'm going to do that off camera, but I will show you and give you measurements of what I've put in there just so you can make your own. But basically it's just an aluminum tube that gets pressed in into what's sticking out there of the seal surface so that I can fill this whole area up with some type of epoxy, JB weld or whatever. That's it for me for tonight. Until next time, take care.